Hi guys, welcome to Tempest Debates lecture on flowing in public forum. My name is Ariel and I am currently a senior at Vestavia Hills High School. I have been debating public forum for 4 years now and Congress debate for 3 years. So let's get started. So before we get into the first drill, basically what flowing is in debate is sort of like taking notes. So flowing is really important because you want, it gives you a baseline, a foundation of keeping organized what the arguments are in the round, what your opponents are arguing, what you're arguing, and how your arguments interact with each other. And keeping an organized flow is really important because it helps you make strategic decisions later on in the round. So for our first drill, it's going to introduce you to the concept of flowing. So I'm going to play the video, We Didn't Start the Fire, and he's going to start listing a bunch of things. And I want you to take a piece of paper, get a pen, and write down, don't pause the video, just see how many of the things that he lists you can write down. I did this drill when I was a novice in debate, and it really helped introduce me to the idea and the concept of flowing. And it's a fun way to test how good you are with speed and how many you can write down, because I definitely did not do a very good job the first time I did this. Okay. So I'm gonna go ahead and play the video for it. I might end it a little earlier, but you should definitely go to YouTube, find the actual video and play it, and see how many you can get out of the whole thing.
Johnny Ray, opposite the Walter Winchell, Joe DiMaggio, Joe McCarthy, Richard Nixon, Studebaker, television, North Korea, South Korea, Marilyn Monroe. Rosenberg, Sage, Bomb, Super Ray, Pat Moon, John Brando, the King and I, and the Catcher in the Rye, Eisenhower vaccine, England's got a new queen, Marciano, Liberace, Santayana.
So that was an idea. I didn't play the whole thing, but you should definitely go through, pause this video, go find the real thing, play it all the way through. But for the sake of time, we're going to continue. So how many did you get right? Yeah. That is a question you should be thinking about. Like, usually flowing isn't this hard, but it definitely does get you in the mindset of writing things when you hear them. And that's essentially what flowing is. So here is an example of a flow in public forum debate. So the first step of keeping a good flow is dividing your paper up into fours. And I really recommend that you guys use printer paper, just like a regular size printer paper. This one's a little messy. And use two of them, have two of them. The first one should be your pre-flow, which is before the round, you want to flow your own case. And that should be on one piece of paper. and the other piece of paper should be where you flow your opponent's case once you get in the round. So let's look at an example of one of these flows. So when I say flow your opponent's case, that's exactly what this first column is doing. So this right there, this whole thing, is you flowing your opponent's case. So just like in the first drill, when we listed a bunch of things we heard, that's exactly what you're doing in a debate round. When your opponent comes up and gives their speech, you're going to be flowing. You're going to be writing down what you hear, what they're saying, so you know what their argument is and what their evidence is saying. So let's take a closer look at this first column. So this is obviously a negation speech. And their first contention labeled as C1. That is how you want to label your contentions. You never want to write in full sentences because you really don't have enough time to get enough information down. We call that a shorthand, and we're going to talk about that later. So we see that this is about Catalonia and Spain, and this is what the argument is essentially about, and it's something about it being inevitable. So then the first subpoint is labeled as A, is fragmentation. So then there's a percentage here, 27%. That's really good because you're getting specific information about the case. And then you see the subpoint B is the economy, as it says right here. And there seems to be two points within economy, trade and welfare. And within these points, there's a lot of information about what that argument is about. And the more specific your flow is, the easier it is for you to keep track of what they're arguing and how you're supposed to respond to their arguments. So then that's basically what your first column is going to be. So now let's look at the second column. This is the second column. This is basically your rebuttal column. So what that means is that after your opponents give their speech, their case, after crossfire happens, there's going to be the two rebuttals. This seems like the pro rebuttal to the con case. So as you can see, they are all numbered, 1, 2, 3. And that's really important. You want to number the contentions, the responses, so you keep it organized. And basically what this column means is that for their first contention, the overall point, their opponents gave 3 responses to refute it. And then for subpoint A, their opponents seem to give 1 response. And then for subpoint B, opponents seem to give 2 responses. And you can tell which contention that their opponents are responding to because it's written right beside it. And then for their second point here on welfare, there seems to be 2 responses as well. So in a good round, you want to see that the rebuttal side is really, the ink is really filling up compared to the constructive, the case side, because what that means is that their opponents are responding a lot, and there's a lot to like refute and debate, and it means that they're ultimately doing a good job actually getting and attacking those arguments. So then this is the third column. This is what we call the frontline and summary column. So essentially in this third column, what it is frontline is basically defending your case after your opponents attack it. So, and it's for summary. So summary is where the round starts to condense. We're gonna talk about summary later. This is just the overview. And you see how there is a arrow right here? That means that the red is extending that argument, which means that that is what they're condensing onto later in the round. So this is what they're condensing it down to. And then you can see that the black responded, which means that's their response to it. And you see them extending their responses, extending their impact, and extending their overall narrative. That is what the arrows indicate. And then in this final column, this is the final focus. This is essentially what the round narrows and funnels down to. And as we can see, that we started with this whole thing, and then we ended with this block. which is exactly how a debate round should be. It should funnel down into your most important argument, and that's exactly what's extended here. And this is their opponents responding to what they extended here. Now you can tell how a flow keeps track of what arguments are presented around and overall how these arguments interact with each other, because we see a lot of interactions with the different colors. I would advise that you flow the pro side in either blue or black, and then the con side in a different color. I typically like to use red, but it's ultimately up to you. You just need two different colors, and I really do not suggest I do not suggest flowing in pencil. Okay, so let's look at another example. So here is another way of flowing. So this is actually a round that I observed. So in this round, what happened was I used one sheet of paper and I turned it sideways. And I honestly don't recommend this when you are debating, but it is an option if you guys want it. So what happens here is you see that the whole four column thing is still kind of playing out. Like this is column 1, 2, 3, and 4. And then for the other side, this is column 1, 2, 3, and 4, except they're on the same paper now. So this right there, that is the pro case that I flowed. And if we zoom in, let's look at specifically how you flow a case. So what we call a shorthand is just abbreviating what you do to in a point where you understand what you're talking about, but you're not writing the whole thing. So an example of where I abbreviated is, instead of writing contention to, I wrote C2. Instead of writing the name for this contention was probably like healthcare collapse. I just wrote collapse. And then instead of writing decrease and increase, I just drew a down arrow and I drew an up arrow. Instead of writing money, I drew a dollar sign. Instead of writing Medicare for all, I wrote M4A. So that is a very good example of shorthand, so you can get as much information in as little time as possible. So another example of what you want to label your things as is you want to label the impacts of the case. So how I label the impact is I just write an I and I draw a circle around it. And as we can tell, the impact that they were impacting on this round is POV, which means poverty. And then I labeled specific links with numbers. So you can see this is link number 1. This is link number 2. This is link number 3. And that is a really good way to condense what you're saying and actually get as much detail in as possible. So let's look at some more specifics. So when you are flowing case, you really want to write down the important card names. So as you can see, I wrote down Bradford 13. And then I also wrote down Taylor 02. So 02 essentially means the year, Taylor's the author's last name. And this is really important because if you write down your card names, if you think it's sketchy, you can always ask your opponents for the Taylor card or the Bradford card, which ultimately shows why organizing your flows is really important to doing well in a debate round. Okay, so now let's look at the rebuttal column, which is the second one. So as we can see, this is the neg rebuttal to the pro case. For their first contention, they seem to have given around 4 responses because they're all numbered and they end when the second contention starts. So for their second contention, there seems to be one whole response with 3 subpoints to that response. So I wrote all of that down because you want to know what your opponents are saying to your case in order to defend your case against their arguments. And then for this last point, there seems to be around 3 more arguments. Same for this side. There seems to be a lot of responses and a lot of responses here that I really ran out of room to flow it. But this is why I recommend flowing vertically instead of horizontally. So that is the rebuttal side. So let's talk about the third column, the author column is the summary slash frontlining. So as we can see here, the NEG team defended against their opponent's responses. So basically, the argument was that the NEG was arguing that by getting rid of private insurance under Medicare for All, the stock market is going to collapse because those private insurance stocks are going to be hurt. In response to that, their opponent said they're going to diversify in other ways, that Medicare for All is going to compensate them, that Medicare for All allows for insurance, just different supplemental covers. So then how the other team responded to this was, and defended their case was, that it makes zero sense because Medicare for All is destroying an entire industry, and historically it's been proven because we've lost $28 billion just with the threat of Medicare for All, and that led to a decrease in market value. So that was a defense against their opponent's responses. So then that's the same thing over here. So pro is defending against what con said. Like, you can tell what they're defending to because I wrote it right beside it. You really want to block your responses together so you understand where everything goes and how it pieces together like a puzzle. And here's where the arrows come in. So this arrow indicates that this progressive tax argument was in summary, which means that it is one of the arguments that the pro side is focusing on. They also talk about lifting 400 million people out of poverty, and I'm going to assume that because there's an arrow here, that's what the round is really boiling down into. That's another example of how exactly flows work. So here is just a more detailed and magnified version of shorthand and numbers and how to keep track of everything. And a version of this presentation is on our website under the resource tab. So I really encourage you guys to check it out if you want this presentation for yourself. So now we're going to look at another drill. So for this drill, I'm going to read a case on the Medicare for All topic. And I want you guys to take out a piece of paper, take out a red pen, because this is a red case. I mean, this is a NEG case. Sorry about that. And I want you to flow it for practice after our lesson. Just a review, you should include shorthand, number the contentions, get some card evidence names in, and yeah. Okay. If everyone is ready, I will begin. We negate. Our sole contention is innovation. Currently, the US leads the world in pharmaceutical innovation. Greenwood of Morning Consult 17 writes that pharmaceutical innovation in the U.S. delivers more drugs than the rest of the world combined, with 57% of new medicines originating from the U.S. This innovation is a product of the private sector. FAM 19 writes that in 2017, the U.S. spent a total of $182 billion in medical research. The largest portion of R&D dollars came from the industry investment of $121 billion. The company driving this research are small. The ARP 17 further contextualizes that about 70% of industry sales come from drugs originating in small companies. With this, innovation from the pharmaceutical industry is on the rise. The Access to Morning Foundation 14 writes that in 2012, the number of products in the pipeline to developing worlds has grown by 47%, and more companies are experimenting with innovative business models. Problematically, enacting Medicare for All would cut innovation. Sandy 19 writes that a government-run healthcare system would undercut the ability of pharmaceutical companies to develop R&D to discover new treatments and therapies that improve patient outcomes. This is for two reasons. The first is slashing budgets. Frank 17 writes that a defining feature of pharmaceutical industry is the high cost and risk of bringing new drugs to the market, with its costing companies hundreds of millions of dollars per new drugs. As a result of high cost of production, pharmaceutical companies invest large amounts into R&D. Indeed, Investopedia 20 quantifies that pharmaceutical companies spend around 17% of their internal budgets on R&D. Problematically, Medicare for All would mean slashing the internal research and development budgets. Cudmore 20 writes that with a single payer system, the U.S. government would bring about a decrease in prices that would cause pharmaceutical companies to lose, on average, 25% of their total revenue, equating to more than the entire R&D budget for most companies. Because of its high volatility, unlike other markets investments such as marketing, R&D would be the first to go. Gina of the Hill 18 writes that expectations of profits drive pharmaceutical investments. Since the success of innovative drugs reaching patients is about 1 out of 12 drugs, they are more likely to cut on certain innovative products. Second is scaring investors. Hagen Dorn of the University of London writes that because R&D is so expensive and small companies which innovate the most are most likely dependent on external sources of revenue. However, Medicare for All would scare investors away, and even the mere threat of it in the past did exactly that. Walsh 19 explains that the surging popularity of Medicare for All caused pharmaceutical stocks to plummet as investors were scared by it. Loveless 19 furthers that the pharmaceutical giants United Health Group's stock price fell 13% over concerns of possible changes to the U.S. healthcare system. And past regulations, such as Clinton's pharmaceutical price reforms, did exactly just that and caused stock prices to decrease by 52%. The impact is stopping superbugs. Tosh of Mayo Clinic explains that superbugs are strains of bacteria, viruses, parasites that are resistant to the medications commonly used to treat their infections. Because of their immunity to certain medications, Pew 19 writes the severity of the superbug threat shows an urgent need for innovation of new antibiotics. Superbugs will cause catastrophic damage if no innovation is done. Forbes 19 writes that these superbugs are expected to kill 10 million people per year by 2050 if nothing is done by it, by innovating. And that's ultimately why you negate. Okay, so that was the second drill that is more relative to debate. And before I end this lesson, I want to point out a few things. The first is that if you ever want to practice doing flowing drills, you can get someone to read a case, flow it, get someone to rebut the case, flow it, and just keep practicing like that. But if you also want some assistance with flowing, or if you want one of our instructors to read a case and you flow it, please don't hesitate to reach out to us via email. We will get back to you as soon as we can. Our email is found on our website. And I also want to point out that if you ever want to submit a flow for us to review and critique and give feedback on, just email the flow to us and we will definitely get to it as soon as we can. So I want to thank everyone for tuning in to today's lecture. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out. And I hope everyone learned something from this flowing lecture. Okay. Have a good day, everyone.